Welcome to Summary of Talks on the Gita by Vinoba Bhave. Chapter 1. Yoga of Despondency. In the background of Gita is a war between two families ready to start. Arjuna, the main hero on one side, looks at the family members, elders and friends on the other side and experiences a strong sense of frustration for infighting in the family. Although he was a great warrior, he merely broke down by thinking on the utter futility of this war, and in that moment of depression, he asks his mentor about what he should do. The answer given by Sri Krishna is equally unexpected. He says, "Your present reluctance to fight is illusion. Your problem is not regarding fight, but the fight against my relatives, my brothers, my friends." Krishna says that your real fight has to be against I and mine, rather than the fight outside. It is in this context of how to come out of our ego, that is I, and the result of the ego, that is my, that all the 17 chapters have been commented upon. Chapter 2. Self-knowledge and equanimity. The chapter deals with non-conventional definition of performance of duty, Swadharma. This concept of Swadharma in India of 1932 was largely interpreted as Hindu Dharma or its sects and subsects, along with the rituals and signs on the forehead, a mala or a rosary, a particular type of dress or the naming, caste and sex. Vinoba's contribution to the interpretation of Swadharma is unique when he says that our Swadharma comes to us with such ease and naturalness that we should cherish it without effort. But because of many kinds of illusion, this does not happen, or else, it is performed with great difficulty, or even if it is practiced, it gets corrupted with many sorts of faults. There are many external forms assumed by the illusion, but if we examine them, only one thing is at the bottom of it all, namely, a restricted and shallow identification of oneself with the body. Myself and those related to me through the body sets the limits of my expansion. Anyone outside this circle is to me a stranger or an enemy. This identification with the body builds a wall around me and cuts me off, and I regard only the bodies as me and mine. Falling into this double trap of identification of oneself and one's people with the body, we start putting up all sorts of little walls. Almost everybody is busy doing this. One man puts up an enclosure called attachment to family and lives in it. Another builds and lives in an enclosure called attachment to nation. But what is the result of this? Only one thing: the germs of base thoughts multiply and the health, which is Swadharma, is destroyed. The practice of Swadharma, or the duty towards oneself, family, society and nation, is to be progressively achieved by converting the intelligence or buddhi to discriminating intelligence or vivek buddhi, which is also called wisdom or pragya. Towards the end of this long chapter in the Gita are described the qualities of the man of steadfast mind, that is sthit pragya, the embodiment of self-control, that is controlling the organs of perception and action, or indriyas. This control is not easy. But to do as the tortoise does, drawing in its limbs in times of danger and using them when it is safe to draw the senses away from objects and to use them for higher services, this discipline is difficult but can be achieved by effort. A person established in pragya or wisdom becomes more balanced or equanimous and experiences his higher self, which is beyond passion, greed and arrogance. Chapter 3. Yoga of Action. The third chapter on Karma Yoga or Yoga of Action was interpreted in context of then prevailing life in India. People in towns and villages were in high state of inactivity. Many of them had taken to addiction to tobacco, opium or country liquor. Men were most of the time gossiping, and most of the manual work was thrust upon women. In the name of religion, high-class Hindus had developed a strong dislike towards poor members of society and were treating women as second-class citizens. In large cities, men had taken to English education and lifestyle as the highest aim of life. Manual work was to be avoided, and white-collar generation came into significant existence. People became intellectuals rather than intelligent. There was inactivity in villages and fruitless activity in cities. In this context, Vinoba, like his predecessor Tilak, once again draws the attention of Hindu society that Gita is not for sannyasis but for householders, and Swadharma is to act. Dignity of labor and maintaining health by simple natural means was already established by his mentor Gandhi as a part of Swadharma. Vinoba adds to the list the concept of bhavna or love as important ingredients of work. Work has to be done for maintaining health, tilling and harvesting of land, or craftsmanship of an artisan, or merchandising of goods by merchants, etc. All this should be directed towards growth of soul by adding love and earning money by fair means in return for work, as a householder is expected to do. As he illustrates this chapter, he says that result of karmayogis or skillful workers' action is that while his life goes on smoothly, his body and mind are radiant, and society too prospers. Besides these two benefits, he also receives the great gift of chittashuddhi or purity of mind. The karma yogi's work is a form of prayer or jap. His mind is purified by it, and the clear mind receives the image of gyan or true knowledge. Illustrating this concept further, he gives example of Sena, the barber. As he cleaned other people's heads, wisdom came to him. Look, I remove the dirt from others' heads, but have I ever removed the dirt from my own head, from my own mind? The language of the spirit came to him through his work. Again he says that as we weed the field, the karmayogi or skillful worker gets the idea of removing the weeds of habit and passion from his heart. He concludes that karmayogi acting thus, through the terms of his own trade or occupation, gains knowledge of perfection. Chapter 4. Vikarma, the key to Karma Yoga. Chapter 4 brings in another new concept of Vikarma, or inward effort, as the key to yoga of action. Without this key, the lock of ultimate purity or self-knowledge will not and cannot open. This state has been defined as desirelessness. It is a quality of mind. As a means of creating this, the pursuit of Swadharma is not enough, other aids are needed. For this, we need to purify the mind. By self-examination, we have to cleanse the mind of its dirt. When Vikarma, or the action of the mind and heart, enters into Karma, or outward action, desirelessness or purity grows within us little by little. Without inward effort, he illustrates a case of social worker like this. To serve people who are poor or lame or are unhappy and in difficulties, and to make them happy is the duty that falls to us in the ordinary course. But we should not conclude, therefore, that all social workers have become karmayogis. If the attitude of mind or bhavna in social service is not pure, it can become a terrifying thing. If the outward action is not moistened by the heart's affection, then the performance of Swadharma would remain barren. It would not bear the flower and the fruit of desirelessness. Moreover, where the heart is not engaged, egoism too would show its head. Sick men are usually peevish, and those who nurse them without the true spirit of service will only be disgusted. When the inner feeling goes with the action, the latter is transformed into something unique. The power that karma develops at the touch of Vikarma is indescribable. The infinite power of the practice of Swadharma lies latent. Touch it with Vikarma and see what work it can do. In the resulting explosion, desire and anger are destroyed, and the way made clear for attainment of supreme wisdom. When you apply vikarma to karma, the latter begins to acquire divine radiance. The mother strokes her child's back. A hand moves up and down a back, and no more. But who can describe the feelings arising in the hearts of the mother and the child from this commonplace action? What do we mean by saying that, by pouring vikarma into karma, it becomes a karma? If we mean that, while acting, we seem not to act, we do not feel the burden of action. Though we act, we are not the doer. By vikarma, by inner purity, karma ceases to be karma. An action performed with pure heart does not attach itself to us. It leaves no residue of sin or virtue, pap or punya, else, what a heavy pressure of action would our hearts and minds have to bear. We feel that action crowds in on us from all sides, we feel that it has caught us by the throat. Just as the waves of the sea dash with force against the land and make channels into it, the complexity of action or karma enters the mind and agitates it. The quality of pleasure and pain, sukh and dukh develops. All peace is lost. The action takes place and is over, but its force remains behind. Action corrupts the mind and destroys sleep. But if, with karma, we combine vikarma, then, however much work you do, you will not feel its strain. The mind becomes still, steady, and radiant, like the pole star. Saints, though engaged in a thousand actions, do not allow a ripple to arise in the still waters of their mind. One can never understand this miracle until one goes to a saint and sees it. Though surrounded by libraries and reading rooms, man everywhere still remains a monkey without culture or knowledge. Though knowledge spreads so rapidly, how does man's mind manage to remain still empty? One man says that human memory is getting weaker, another that men are losing the power of concentration. Lord Krishna said to Arjuna, "You have been listening to so far, too many things, and your mind is dazed. Till it gets steady, you will not see the way clearly. Stop reading books and listening to people, and now take sanctuary with the saints. There, you can read the book of life. There, silent speech clears all your doubts. By going there, you will understand how utterly serene the mind can be while performing continuous service. You will understand how, though action rages without, the heart can be turned to produce unbroken music." Chapter 5. The two aspects of a karma, yoga and sannyas. Vinoba spent several years to absorb this chapter, which he considers key to the whole book. Summary of his deep study is the final goal of yoga and sannyas. Action without activity. These two traditions of spiritual seekers in India, large majority of householders engaged in social and economic activity, and making themselves fitter for experience by constantly adding inward effort of purity to their external work, and a minority group who do not get married, and consequently cut themselves off from social and economic activity, get absorbed mainly in inward effort doing minimum external work to keep life going. Both these groups ultimately come to the same result. Action without fatigue, without stress, with very high value-adding power, power which move mountains, revolutionized societies like power of Buddha, Jesus, or Gandhi. Although both traditions lead to same result, the path of action is preferred because it is safe. To my mind, the reason why it is safe is that it can be practiced successfully, from the humblest to the mightiest. Indian history has many actual examples of men who got the results of self-realization in this way. Explaining the beauty and spiritual purpose of action, Vinoba explains that external actions reveal the real quality of our minds. He says a man becomes angry because anger was within, an external action created circumstances by which it came out. If we do not act, we cannot test our mind that it has anger, jealousy, hatred, etc. Our action talks. Our action is a mirror which shows us our true form. When we act and discover our own defects, we are impelled to employ vikarna or inward action to remove them. When actions do not distort the mind, when it becomes natural and normal, that is, it becomes sahaj, it becomes a karma, action without intense results. Example of sun is taken to illustrate this final result, a karma, the goal of all spiritual practices. It shines, gives life to the whole world. As sun rises, people get ready for work. Birds start coming out of nest. But sun is just shining. It is normal and natural for sun to shine. All activity is inspired by his presence, but still he is the witness. Doing nothing though doing all things, to do all things by doing nothing, both alike, are yoga. However, to reach the goal of doing nothing by doing all things, the path of karma yoga, yoga of action is to be preferred, because it is both the way and the goal. Where the path ends, goal is there. There is room in karma yoga for effort and practice. Through this path of action, one can learn to control the senses little by little. Ease in practice distinguishes karma yoga, or the path of action, from sannyas path of renunciation, but in the state of perfection, both are the same. This is a karma, action without activity.